In addition to the GI tract, there are a few accessory organs that are very crucial for digestion being able to happen. And we're going to take a look at three of those accessory organs. We're going to start with the liver. The liver is actually the largest organ that we have in the abdomen. The liver is situated in the upper right of the abdomen. Stomach was in the upper left. Liver's in the upper right. And the liver does a really important job of filtering the blood. We've said that the kidneys do that. But the liver does it as well. It filters out different things. It deals with a lot of the toxins that are in the blood. And the cells of the liver are really special in a couple of key ways. The cells of the liver are called hepatocytes. And they're arranged into sort of like these plates that are just one or two cells thick. In between those plates, there are a lot of capillaries, which are called sinusoids. And the capillaries, or sinusoids, they're fenestrated. They have little pores that allow blood to pass through. There's no basement membrane, so it's a little bit different than what we saw in the kidneys at the glomerulus. No basement membrane, so more things can pass through. And the hepatocytes, they have these amazing abilities to regenerate. That's actually really important given how many toxins the liver has to process. So regeneration of the liver, this is something that has been demonstrated in mice. In mice, if they that what they've done is removed the liver or removed a good portion of the liver, and within a week, almost all of it or two-thirds of it, a good portion of it has grown back just within a week. So these are cells that are capable of regenerating very quickly. That being said, there are limits when the liver undergoes extensive damage. When it tries to regenerate, sometimes it doesn't regenerate in the same sort of network pattern. Sometimes the sinusoid pattern through the hepatocytes is lost. And so that can be very serious. This is essentially what cirrhosis of the liver is. Cirrhosis of the liver is something that can occur as a result of damage over time, damage due to, for example, too much alcohol, or hepatitis viruses can cause cirrhosis of the liver too. Cirrhosis is a buildup of sort of fibrous scar tissue in the liver, and that disrupts the normal flow of blood through the liver. So that can be very, very serious. This can end up leading to consequences in other organs as well, including the brain. Okay, just a picture of cirrhosis. Here's a normal healthy liver. Here's a liver with cirrhosis, so very extensive damage. And this is permanent. This is not something that can be corrected once it has happened. So if cirrhosis is due to alcoholism, what's the prognosis? What are the chances of survival? If the person stops drinking alcohol, then they have a 65% chance of surviving 3 years. But if they don't stop drinking alcohol, then there's no chance of surviving. That's how crucial the liver is in terms of what it's doing. So how does all of this tie in with digestion? Well, it turns out substances that are absorbed in the GI tract, instead of being routed directly into the bloodstream that circulates all through the body, first that blood is routed to the liver. So the liver is the first thing that would have to process substances that are absorbed from the stomach and the small intestine. Remember, we said alcohol is something that can pass directly through. It can be absorbed by the stomach. So it's alcohol is a substance that can overwhelm the liver quickly. If there's a lot of alcohol being absorbed, then the liver is not going to be able to process it all quickly enough. And so consequently, the alcohol can end up in circulation and can affect organs like the brain, and that's what causes intoxication. So let's see here. The liver is special in that it has a few really key functions. Filtering the blood is one thing, but it does a couple of other things. It also produces bile. Bile is something that helps with the digestion of salts. Bile contains bile pigments, also known as bilirubin. That ends up leading to the characteristic color of actually both urine and feces. It gives them their color. There's a tie-in with that and what microorganisms are doing. You want to come up with mommy? You want mommy to come with you? I'll be right there, okay? So bile salts. Bile salts help to emulsify lipids. We looked at that earlier in the semester. And then there are other things in bile as well. But bile is something that is produced and secreted by the liver when we're eating. When we're not eating, bile gets stored in the gallbladder. We'll come back to the gallbladder in just a moment. I'll be right back. Okay, let's talk about this this pathway that blood takes again. So blood that's absorbed in the GI tract, nutrients that are absorbed into the blood in the GI tract, remember the capillaries that sort of line the GI tract, those capillaries lead to the hepatic portal vein. This is the vein that feeds into the liver. What is it? What is the word portal referring to? Portal systems are a little bit unusual. So remember back when we talked about blood vessels, usually we go from an artery, branch out into a capillary bed, and then those converge back into a vein. Well, portal systems are a little bit different. What we're doing in a portal system is going from capillaries, the capillaries in the GI tract, those lead to a vein, the vein that feeds into the liver, and then in the liver we have another capillary bed. So we go from capillaries to a vein to another capillary bed and then into another vein. So let's just follow through on the picture here. The capillaries from the GI tract lead to the hepatic portal vein. That's this blue one right here. So blood comes in through this hepatic portal vein. And notice right here, it actually merges with another blood vessel. This is an artery. This is blood that's coming from systemic circulation. So there's some mixing of blood. We've got blood from the GI tract and blood from normal systemic circulation. Those merge together and they flow through all these sinusoids throughout the liver. The sinusoids are the capillaries. Those sinusoids hold some special cells. They have the Kupffer cells, which we mentioned in the immune system. Those are like resident macrophages. They are there and they're ready to phagocytose bacteria that might have found their way into the blood. So there's an immune presence right there. The hepatocytes, other hepatocytes are really key for dealing with drugs and toxins, removing those from the blood. And there are a couple of different ways that that can happen. Sometimes the liver takes one of these molecules and degrades it. So it changes it in some way, turns it into a less toxic molecule by performing a chemical reaction on it. Or the other thing that can happen is the liver might collect those substances and route them into the bile tract. So put it back with the bile. The bile is going to go into the intestine. And so this is a way of potentially routing things into the feces. So getting rid of things by elimination in feces. So come back up to this picture here for a minute. We were looking at the blood flow through the sinusoids. Notice we also have this other green vessel. This is illustrating the production of bile. Bile is produced by the liver cells, and the bile actually flows in the other direction. It's going to flow, make its way to this vessel right here. This is a bile ductule. It's going to lead to the bile duct, and then that will open up into the small intestine. We'll see that in just a minute. Okay, so liver, major functions, produce bile. And then manage this hepatic portal system, detoxify the blood. Another thing that we already know about with the liver is that it's very crucial for carbohydrate metabolism and lipid metabolism. This was the site where glucose can be stored. The liver cells are very good at storing glucose. They're also very good at breaking down glycogen in order to free glucose molecules for circulation. So that's a little bit of review. And then finally, the last thing to note is the liver is actually the site where a lot of the plasma proteins are produced. Plasma proteins that are in the blood, where do they come from? Produced by the liver. So four real key functions, very, very different functions, but all being done in this one organ. So let's come back to the bile. The bile is produced by the liver, travels down this bile ductule. That's going to lead to the bile duct. So take a look at this layout. This is introducing the gallbladder, this green thing right here. Okay, so the liver is what's making the bile. That bile is going to flow into the common bile duct. And if we're having a meal with fat, what needs to happen is that bile will flow into the small intestine in order to emulsify the fats. And then later on, down the way in the intestine, a lot of those bile salts will get taken back up by the hepatic portal vein and get recirculated. This recirculation, this happens like 6 to 10 times a day. This is actually very efficient. This means that we're recycling the bile salts. We can reuse them instead of just losing it all in the feces each time. If we're not having a meal, or if there's excess bile, then what happens is it's stored in the gallbladder. So the gallbladder is another example of an accessory organ and stores the bile. So one problem that can come up is this gallbladder can have stones, gallstones that can form in it. Here's a good picture showing that gallstones in the gallbladder. Gallstones are hard mineral deposits. A lot of times their primary constituent is cholesterol. So that can be a problem. If this gets severe enough, if it gets bad enough, then the gallbladder might need to be removed. That's generally something, there's some dietary modifications if a person has their gallbladder removed, but generally there's no huge consequence on digestion because, again, it's not the gallbladder that's making the bile, it's just storing the bile. So there's still a liver, liver is still producing bile, and it can still be secreted into the intestine.